Well, it's great to have my friend and returning guest, Dr. Robert W. Malone. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing good, David. I guess we can call this the bearded ones.
Well, we're still excited to see all the different opportunities we have to get accountability. Your Substack, Malone.news, has provided a whole host of different kind of threads, narratives, shall we say, about kind of the implications of the election and what opportunities might avail themselves for people interested in public health accountability and also just issues related to constitutional governance. You cover all of that on your Substack, don't you?
Well, thanks. I appreciate that. We treat our Substack as a job and put out at least one essay a day. Lately, we've been hitting two because the news has been kind of moving along. We do try to cover a scope and not just bombard our readers with inside baseball politics. It's easy to do, and a lot of people just focus on one little aspect, the COVID crisis or the jab or bears or whatever. They go down through all kinds of little silos. And I'm glad to have experts like Jessica Rose and so many others doing that. But I don't think I add a lot of value when you have a landscape that has a lot of experts in it. I have my core competency, but I think that I can provide a lot more value to our readers by myself and my wife covering a broader range of topics, and they seem to appreciate that. They like having a break. One of our most popular is when we talk about life on the farm and homesteading. And of course, if it wasn't for the Friday Fundies and the Sunday Strip, these aggregates of memes, I think we probably would have had starving dogs, horses, and humans here on the farm, because those collections of memes are super, super popular.
I've got I saw your post on that you published on December 2nd of this year, celebrating simple gifts, seeking a peaceful, connected centeredness. This is not typically the headlines you read about in political blogs or cultural blogs.
Well, like I said, I think it's important to give our readers a break, provide them with a little bit of breath, and they seem to appreciate that. But we're in an interesting time where there's so much anger, there's so much division and strife that coming back to basics and so much emphasis on kind of the bicoastal elite formulation of the nature of the world, which is this overly politicized view in which everything is related back to various political agendas. And that, I think, really doesn't play that well in most of America, the red America, all these pejoratives, the flyover states, the various ugly things that Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden have said about people. That's really demeaning. And one of the things that I find really unpleasant about modern bicoastal culture is the denigration of the nobility of work. And that was what kind of triggered that particular essay, was celebrating the nobility of just getting a job done, doing something physical. In that case, it was the fact that Sunday morning I woke up, and or was it Monday morning? At time all compresses. I woke up, and first thing I found out was the water heater wasn't working. And then I went out to feed the horses and found that one of our freeze-proof yard hydrants, one of, I don't know, 12 or 13, had frozen and burst at the head, and was spraying water all over the place, which, when you're on well water, that's a bit of a crisis, because you'll drain out the well pretty quick. And so that had to be fixed. And then the water heater had to be fixed. I managed to accomplish fixing the digging out and fixing the yard hydrant despite the cold weather. on Sunday, and then yesterday I managed to get the water heater replaced, so yay. But it's I one of our things with the Substack is, frankly, Jill and I wake up in the morning and the first thing we talk about is what we're going to write on Substack. And it's not very, elegant or romantic, but it's the way our lives are. And so that, that we try to use events in our lives and the people around us and the experiences we're having as and what we observe in media, et cetera, as fodder for really taking a deeper look and helping our listeners to better understand, our readers to better understand the nature of the world, at least as we see it.
So, you do that, and that's so good to have a focus on the physical and the real, because as the internet and the digital culture and everything takes over so much of our lives, there's a kind of detachment from the body and the earth that takes place in relationships that can get kind of ghostly, or whatever, ghastly, maybe you would put that word there too,
How about
which
both?
it, yeah, exactly. Because you become ethereal and relationships become ethereal and everything becomes Gnostic and it becomes detached from the incarnational reality of reality, proper capital R. And that's kind of, it's important to do things in the real world, including meeting people and drinking food, drinking and eating food and having fellowship and having dialogue. As nice as our conversations are on Zoom that we've done over the years, and remember, I was interviewing you before it was cool, and when Joe Rogan picked you up, I was interviewing you before Joe Rogan, by the way. So I was an early conversational partner with you when the darkest times of that COVID stuff was going on. And all that's fun, but it's so much better to do it in person, if you can, and have conversations.
Absolutely. And I think that's your words are quite wise there, David. They totally resonate with me. And we have, as I recall, met in person also.
Yeah,
And I think that these virtual meetings can be effective in commerce and, all kinds of work, even governmental things. But they're most effective if, what's good about them is you can catch the nuance of people's expressions, which adds a lot. It's a lot of our conversation, or the complexity of our language is transmitted through our facial expressions. Just like happens with a lot of animals, but we don't, unlike my horses, we don't twitch our ears, so I guess we're limited that way. But in my experience, as decades as a small business person and consultant, it works best if you also establish a personal relationship with somebody in the physical world, and then you can build upon that in the virtual world. But there's no substitute for actual meeting somebody, shaking hands, as you say, breaking bread, and in other ways, establishing a real interaction. And part of that, I think, has to do with determining whether or not you can trust the other person, which of course has a lot to do with whether or not they extend trust to you. You can't have a trusting relationship unless it's mutual.
It reminds me of the Trusted News Initiative. How far that missed the mark. How far that
Oh
missed the
boy, you
mark
do
from
have a
trust.
memory. Back in the day, yes.
I remember you
Yeah,
talking
so
about that on our show. Yeah, that was fun.
that was that. Thank you for that. That was really early. And the wiki called Wiki Spooks attributes me as the person that broke the story about the Trusted News Initiative. It was right out there in the open, but I did kind of emphasize it early on in a way that others had overlooked. And of course, now all the censorship industrial complex, the globalist censorship activities, the GARM agreement, all of these operations that seek to control information has kind of become common knowledge now. It's, talking about the TNI, the Trusted News Initiative, almost seems so yesterday. But it's still out there, and they still, the BBC in particular, and this arm of the British government, their censorship board, still controls British news. They are really quite heavy-handed. And GB News, that Nigel Farage is famously associated with, has experienced that in a pretty severe way. The Brits and the Canadians have, in many ways, pioneered, let's say, the new world order that as it relates to information control.
I mean, you see people, you probably could be liable to be arrested, like a lot of these British guys are being arrested right now for things they say on social media, right?
Well, this is one reason why I decided that we travel a lot, but we just, Jill and I made a decision that we were not going to travel through Heathrow anymore because of that risk. Now, truth be told, I had the privilege and pleasure of meeting Nigel Farage during the election watch night in Palm Beach. We both were in the front row waiting for Donald Trump to make his opening speech, which happened. And so we had a chat while we were there. Unfortunately, Fox News zoomed in on me, so I got a lot of feedback about that. What are you doing talking to Nigel Farage? But one of the things we talked about was my asking him directly, is it safe for me to travel to the UK right now? Because a lot of that Starmer push, the new PM, from Labour to jail people for social media commentary has resulted in so much blowback, even though those poor souls are now jammed in the clinker, for trivial infractions. But it's generated so much blowback that there's now a massive petition in the UK that seeks to have new elections. And Starmer, despite his kind of super majority in the House of Commons, has really been pushed back on his heels a little bit. So Nigel told me that he thought it was going to be safe for me to fly into the country. But probably I don't want to lead a rally in which I say that Starmer needs to be thrown out of office and all these guys are a bunch of Nazis. So we'll just take a pass on doing those kinds of things.
Well, that's funny that, that our greatest ally, supposedly Great Britain, is looking more and more like a little bit more Soviet, or whatever you want to call it. You're not allowed to entertain the idea of doing a rally in a place that's supposed to be the birthplace of a lot of the foundational principles of liberty that we have in this country. So.
I agree. It's a strange world now in which a lot of the West, a lot of the NATO countries are embracing heavy-handed censorship and information control, thought, really, it's thought control, very, very Orwellian.
And I got to give a public shout out to you. Thank you for helping me enlist the great Dr. Ron Paul back in the action of cutting government. I mean, you tweeted out that interview that I did with Elon, with Ron, kind of asking him to consider, the idea that I had in my mind of him teaming up with Elon. Because in my mind, that started when I watched Elon at the Madison Square Garden rally before the election.
Huh? Were you
He
there
said,
or just virtual?
was that?
Were you there or just
No, I
virtual?
was just watching a clip of him say, Lutnick asked him how much you want to cut, and he said at least 2 trillion. And I heard the crowd roar, and I remember thinking, there was always this false juxtaposition in the first term atmosphere of Trump about the populist versus the limited government guys, and the idea at the time in intelligentsia of conservative DC circles was, oh, this was a repudiation of the libertarian limited government and for the populist. And they were putting this weird kind of false dialectic that wasn't there in my sensibility of it. I found that the American people largely were populist nationalists as well as very limited government libertarian, and that's in a kind of amorphous kind of mixture. And I heard him say, I'm gonna cut $2 trillion. And I remember thinking, Elon's known for a lot of things, but he doesn't really have a track record of cutting government. I mean, he's never done that. So
But
I was like,
he did cut Twitter.
yeah, you cut, but that's a whole nother world when you're doing government. And I thought, who in our lifetime is the gold standard of cutting government as a politician? Ron Paul. Nobody gets close to that voting record since the 70s of consistently being called Dr. No, consistently running for president 2008, 2012. Everybody's laughing at him as he says cut $1 trillion in the first year of his government, of his administration. tackle the Pentagon, tackle corporate welfare before you touch any kind of poor, welfare for the poor. I'm thinking that's the guy who's got the credibility. If
Not to
Elon
mention the
wants to
Fed.
make this,
You missed the Fed.
the Fed. And so, having that moment and asking Ron, and he kind of has this humble self, I don't think it's likely, but yeah, it'd help if they wanted. And then you were one of those guys that helped tweet out that interview and really helped blow it up. And Don Jr. and everybody got excited. And Elon got famously excited. And he's still tweeting out Ron's stuff almost on a daily basis. He's always
That's great.
retweeting his show.
That's
So
fantastic.
what a
So
great alliance.
I first met Ron in person at the Mises Institute a few months ago when I gave the lecture on psychological warfare, psy war, and enforcing the New World Order, which, by the way, is now far and above their most popular broadcast ever.
There you
So that's encouraging. And they have asked me to come back this spring. So
go.
thank you very much to Mises Institute for that support.
Yeah.
But also, what a gift to be able to meet Ron Paul.
Yeah.
And I've met Rand Paul too, but Ron Paul is as far as I'm concerned, sorry, Rand, Ron is head and shoulders above the sun.
Yeah.
And just an amazing American patriot. What a gift. The other day we posted a meme about Ron, in which he's standing in front of a podium, kind of to the side. He looks dejected. He looks worn out. And I think the comment was the face you make after 50 years of being consistently right and no one listening to you.
That's for sure. But he's fought a lifelong crusade. Everybody was laughing at him when he said, "Watch out for the FBI." Everybody laughed at him when he said, "Watch out for CIA." Everybody laughed at him when he said, "We shouldn't be meddling in Ukraine in 2014 and overthrowing, coups
Yeah.
and all this stuff." And literally everything he's talked about, that he was derided and laughed at, and Fox News would cut him off and not show his polls when he was beating people. And it's all come to pass. And he's the most humble guy ever because
Yes,
he
he
doesn't.
is modest, self-effacing, and unfortunately he's getting on. And not as sharp as once, but vindicated and a true American hero and patriot, as far as I'm concerned. And my recommendation, anybody, if you get a chance to meet him, shake his hand, take a picture. I don't know how many more decades we're going to have of Ron Paul, but I think we need to do anything we can to demonstrate respect and honor for his contributions.
And he's like the closest we have to a living founding father in his mindset and philosophy,
Yeah,
in my opinion.
I just a true American hero and blessing. And not all of the founding fathers were so modest, but Ron Paul truly is a humble servant, and deserves just infinite respect as far as I'm concerned.
Well, I appreciate you for sharing that content as well. So I do want to switch gears a little bit. I have a question for you in the sense of you've obviously became kind of well known because of your critiques of the whole public health policy conundrum and the quagmires that we were put into. You were one of, and still are, one of Fauci's most public critics. Do you feel, do you, have you considered doing something with this new administration? Is there something in the works that you can't talk
Yeah, so that
about?
gets a little bit touchy. And David, I was asked point blank by Natalie last night on Bannon's show what I thought of the appointments, and it left no room to wiggle. I couldn't do any kind of a DC sidestep or two-step to get out of that. She asked me straight out to my face, and if I'm gonna continue to support the brand of honesty and integrity, I gotta have to answer the question.
You're kind of like Ron Paul like that. You just call it like this. What is it with
So
these MD? What is it with these politically interested and public MD guys, huh?
I think part of it is because we've kind of been there, done that in terms of getting the degree and going through all the grief to do that. And you know, there's just a whole cluster of things around that, that if for a certain frame of mind, you can just kind of say, okay, so I've done that, and proven myself, and I don't have to mince words.
Right.
So in any case, here's the story, David. About 3 weeks ago, I guess, or maybe it's less, it's, you know, we're all experiencing time compression right
Yeah.
now. But it seems like at least 3 weeks ago, I got this, it's certainly 3 weekends ago, I got this sudden on Sunday, oh my God, you've got to send in your CV and fill out this form and give us your bona fides. And I'd been asked previously to write down my thoughts about reform of the FDA and send it in to Aaron Seary, who's kind of one of the key players in the Bobby HHS Del Bigtree transition team. Apparently, there's multiple HHS transition teams. And so I had done that, and I also put it out on Substack at the same time, so you can find those thoughts on the FDA and reform. So I was asked to submit all this paperwork and stuff Sunday night, which the request came in at like 6, and I was like, no, or at least Monday by noon. So I got it in at like 12:01 on Monday, and I basically haven't heard crickets since. And in the interim, and we write an essay, I wrote the essay about this one also. I was asked by Del Bigtree to tweet out some comment that he had put out about their strategic options in terms of nominees for HHS below Bobby, and in which he had basically said, we have two options. Which do you support? But we already knew which one they'd selected because that's how they've been doing it. The first one was, you know, we could appoint people that the press has identified as anti-vaxxers, and then we'll take all kinds of flack and blah, blah, blah. Or we could appoint people that are more center of the road, haven't been labeled by the press, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, he got back a earful of, you know, WTF. Some people said, well, you should have both or whatever. But bottom line is they've decided, and I argued in my essay that basically the press has already won, which is to say that the pharmaceuticals already industry has already won. And the folks resisting the agenda that Bobby's been talking about, the MAHA agenda, have already won, in that they came out hard and fast against Bobby and intimidated, it appears, the transition team. And so their transition team basically pulled their punches. And instead of appointing people like Kash Patel to FBI, you know, seasoned warriors that really understand the government, they ended up with academics and political quid pro quos. I'm referring to the Surgeon General and others, you know, that are not familiar or experienced with the nefarious ways of DC culture and the deep state, you know, as opposed to Kash Patel, who wrote the book on the deep state and
Yeah.
is all over it and has battled them previously, knows their dirty tricks. You know, these guys coming out of academia, and I'm referring to Johns Hopkins and Stanford, and you can disambiguate who I'm talking about. I really try not to name names, but these are not people that have a significant history of working with these agencies. And so they're going to have a really substantial learning curve in terms of trying to comprehend what they're up against
Right.
and understanding where reform is needed.
Yeah.
That's going to, on a good day, that's going to take them 2 years. And meanwhile, we call them the forces of evil or the deep state or whatever you
Yeah.
want, are just going to further entrench and go about doing their business. And the way I like to put it, you know, I really don't want an administrative position. I turned 65 the other day, And I don't want to spend the next 4 years of my life being backstabbed on a daily basis and having to live in bloody Rockville. I lived in Rockville before, and you know the song, Don't Go Back There, and by REM. And I intend to live by that. And that's basically what it would require is I would have to probably not sell the farm, but I'd have to take out a mortgage, because the price of a condo in Rockville, Bethesda is, or any of those places, unless you want to live in the kind of gritty part of the DC burbs, that, you know, where you better have Tony Fauci level security, or you're gonna be losing your hubcaps at a minimum. It's just not my idea of a good time, and not what I want to spend the latter part of my brief span on this globe doing. I'm glad to. The way I've put it is, if asked to serve my country, I will do my best to do so, the best of my ability, but I don't seek any of these positions. So there's my lengthy answer to your query.
Well, I'm gonna pose to you what I posed to Ron Paul. What about the DOGE with Elon Musk? Now, that's not a government position. That's only 2 years to the anniversary, 250th anniversary. So if Elon Musk were to say, "Hey, Robert Malone, I've got Ron Paul taking on the Fed and corporate welfare. You seem to know where all these creeps and weirdos and this Machiavellian stuff going on in DC and the public health side of things. Would you
Yeah,
help
I
me?"
would. It would be an honor to work with Ramaswamy and Musk. And another one that I've Bannon floated to me some interesting ideas having to do with national security. And the one that I would particularly find tasty, because it's kind of been my, you know, it's the title of the book, right? Cywar Enforcing the New World Order. I've become convinced that the issue is not corruption in the U.S. public health system. The issue is not medical freedom. The issue is really even bigger than freedom per se. It's globalism. And any opportunity to support President Trump in disengaging from the globalist cabal, as that's something I could absolutely lean into. And the one position that I would particularly like that's a formal appointment is special envoy to the World Health Organization, with the mission of getting us out of the World Health Organization. So
Didn't he
that's
get out of it
another
last
thing I would
time? And
enjoy.
didn't he get out of it last time, or what, did it never
He
actually
did. He
happen?
was he but he initiated the process to stop funding, but it has a 12-month timeline on it. And it's one of the early things that Joe Biden rescinded. The very first thing he did, Joe Biden, upon getting into office, was he rescinded Schedule F that Trump had finally gotten in, which is the tool that Trump was going to use to basically make this permanent employee caste, the senior executive service that runs the government, make them at-will employees so they could be fired, because they can't be fired right now. And they're the ones that run the government. They're the ones that will slow walk any of the policies that Bobby or anybody else tries to put in place that they don't like. They, you know, including stuff that comes from the president. We've got this, you know, during Trump term number one, there was a whole lot of passive aggressive slow walking and all kinds of nefarious activities, not the least of which was Janet Woodcock. And the director of BARDA, Rick Bright, directly acting in opposition of President Trump's order to make hydroxychloroquine available. They personally blocked that based on their own bias or because of pharmaceutical industry lobbying or I don't know what. That was a clear case of a explicit presidential directive that these deep staters just ignored and slow walked and then killed it. without his approval.
Is that what they're going to do with these mRNA projects? Are they going to do a rope-a-dope and pull out something similar or different?
So that gets kind of complex, and you'll appreciate, since technically I still have a CV in with these guys, I want to not be shooting my mouth off too much. But nevertheless, the recent select House Select Subcommittee on the coronavirus pandemic investigation report came out, 500 pages plus, 2 years of work. And the one thing that has got those of us, let's say in the resistance, that have been questioning. The one thing that's got everybody's tail in a twist is that this committee report says that Operation Warp Speed was a great success, and then it turns right around and says, out of the other side of its mouth, and so how you can say that OWS was a success and the product that came out of OWS was neither safe nor effective is a classic DC doublespeak. And it's got a lot of people wound up about how much integrity this thing really has. But I think it's a reflection of Donald Trump is at risk for not ha having basically being surrounded by sycophants. And politically, right now, he's riding high in the saddle. No one wants to do anything to piss him off or Susie Wiles, because that's likely to result in retaliation. Just ask the governor of Florida about how that works. So everybody's walking on eggshells, and they don't want to say anything negative about OWS. That's just the political current political reality. I think it's really counterproductive, and it is likely to result in a situation in which there really won't be the accountability in terms of the malfeasance that many of us would like to see.
Well, here's the thing. It's at their own peril. We hope for the best with them, but they have to be clear here. This mandate victory that the American people gave them was marketed, that they were responding to the marketing of people like Tulsi Gabbard and RFK Jr., this dream team. They literally made ads like Marvel comic book trailers,
Yes,
and they
absolutely.
were really, they weren't selling us on all the guys getting a lot of the positions now. That if those were so good, they should have put Marco Rubio and everybody else in the ad if they were so good. But of course, you sell it to the base because the base has certain demands, and then DC has certain demands, and the Senate has certain demands,
Yep.
and the oligarchs that own the United States of America have certain expectations and demands, and we understand that. But if they think that they're just going to be able to like not do anything based on what they've marketed with Nicole Shanahan and all these things, like heal the soil and take care of the Amish way of growing, and if you're not going to do any of that, you're going to be blasted out into the universe. I'm guaranteeing it. No one's
Well,
giving
the
up.
USDA director has virtually no background in farming other than the fact that her parents had a small farm. That's just not encouraging. And I can tell you that for smaller independent farmers and ranchers, they are already feeling betrayed here. At least the woman isn't from Monsanto, but that's or Bayer, right? So things can always be worse, right? But David, your comments mirror exactly kind of my concluding comments in that essay where I talked about the transition team in HHS and what's going on and cited the Del Bigtree tweet. My point of view, I think, is I infer is similar to yours. Make America healthy again and make America great again is not Donald Trump. It's not Tulsi Gabbard. It's not Bobby Kennedy. It's so much bigger. It's sustainable. It's not just populism. It's grounded in real issues and real potential solutions and solid logic. And we need to keep the torch burning, no matter what happens during the next 4 years and whatever compromises are made. And what I argued in that essay was that a lot of the things that all of us would like to see are unlikely to materialize. We're not going to end up corruption in DC. We're not going to kill the deep state, on and on and on. There's a lot of things that we would like to see that it's just not possible, not the least of which is dealing with the bloody deficit over the next 4 years and the
Yeah.
debt. And this was my position when I endorsed Donald Trump before Bobby did. I kind of had to hold my nose about the COVID and the jab, knowing from insider buddies of mine that were in the prior administration and been dialoguing with him a lot that he's just not going to budge on that stuff. But in the face of Harris and the kind of O'Biden administration that has gone on for how many years now, the shadow government that he's set up in DC, Obama I'm referring to, and the lingering effects of the Clintons. In the face of all that, and their endorsement of the globalist agenda and DEI and ESG and all this other stuff, the trashing of the petroleum industry, green energy, global warming, we could just go on and on and on. In the face of all that, there was enough positive marks in the Trump column that I was willing to overlook the fact that it was unlikely, in my opinion, that we were going to get what we wanted in terms of accountability over the COVID crisis. And I was okay with that, and I'm still okay with that. I still think that, remember I said that as far as I'm concerned, the big war is against the bloody globalists, and you called them oligarchs. And I do think that Trump is likely to push back against those UN, WHO, WEF agendas. And he's likely also to, I've become increasingly critical of NATO, which is probably another reason why I'm never going to find myself in an administration in the United States. I think that Trump is going to be skeptical of NATO as it's currently constructed also. I think Trump is likely to get us out of the Ukrainian situation one way or another. I think he's likely to get Netanyahu to chill out on what's going on in Gaza, and he's likely Trump knows that business thrives, except for the defense business. Business thrives in the absence of war,
Yeah.
particularly international trade, and I think he knows that China is our biggest enemy and competitor, and they have infiltrated. By the way, they are all over the federal government. There are Chinese nationals all through the FDA. They staff a large part of the FDA and the NIH. I've learned the hard lesson from people like Frank Gaffney and others that. And Yanya Kellek and the team at Epic Times that you can't naturalize Chinese citizens all have to be considered as likely agents of the CCP. That's just the nature of the world. These people are not free. particularly if they have families back there, they're not autonomous, and they've come out of a system in which they are deeply brainwashed. And to act like they aren't likely to act on behalf of our greatest international competitor and opponent is just naive, or it's complicit. And so, in terms of DOGE, I think that Ramaswamy and Musk need to take a hard look at the composition of these agencies in a lot of different dimensions, whether or not these people are actually coming to work, what they're actually doing, what their actual expertise is. Because, like with a lot of federal hires, including what we're seeing with the transition teams, in DC, it has a lot to do with who you know and this kind of quid pro quo relationship. And from what I'm hearing, it's happening just the same in the HHS transition group. They're pointing people that are their buddies. You can kind of understand why, because we were talking about trusted relationships at the start. These are people that they're already known, people think they can trust them. But that doesn't mean they're the best people for the job. But that's the way things work, right?
I'm hopeful for folks like, I don't want to mention names, but I don't care. It's a friend of mine, Jim O'Neill. I think he could be a good deputy secretary of HHS because he's got a lot of experience, in the world I am in the right place for reform of the FDA and,
That is what Bobby is going to need reporting to him are people like
Have you ever
him.
met Jim O'Neill? He's a
No, I
good
haven't.
guy. Yeah, he's a good guy.
Yeah.
I've known him for
Sorry.
years,
But the
years.
metaphor I think of Kash Patel for FBI is a perfect one. You need
Well, who do
seasoned
you know any honey badgers like that for the health sector?
honey badgers. Unfortunately, the health sector has been so compromised by federal funding through academia, et cetera, that there are very few that understand, that have been in the system, understand it, and have the cojones to get in there and fight. There are a lot of people that understand the system, and it tends to select for people that, want to get along, work within the system, understand what the problems are. And so their solution is to write a memo, maybe a mild protest or objection. If they have a good leader, a transformational leader that they're reporting to, then they might say, well, yeah, you could do this or you could do that or you could do the other thing, and this is how you might do it. But don't expect them to lead the charge. One example that I think illuminates this, and I keep blanking on his name, which is embarrassing, the former Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, the
Ben
neurosurgeon,
Carson.
Ben Carson. Thank you so much. So apparently, Ben Carson, this Hopkins famous neurosurgeon, I think he was chair of neurosurgery, because of his conservative voice and perhaps having to do with his ethnicity, he gets appointed by Trump as a Trump supporter to head up housing and urban development, which is, how's that make any sense at all? He certainly wasn't somebody, other than the fact that he lived in the Baltimore metropolitan area, maybe that made him qualified. But generally, this is not somebody that you would think is qualified to run HUD. Yet, he comes in, he puts together a team, they scrub that place from stem to stern in terms of regulations and excess regulations. And much of the progress that was made under the first Trump term in terms of deregulation can be attributed to him, to Ben Carson. And now in DC, HUD is considered to be one of the most functional agencies around. So that teaches us a couple things. It teaches us the value of a good transformational leader that's committed to a cause. To be able to set up a team and actually get something done, despite all the BS that the bureaucrats and the SES are going to throw against them. And it shows that that leader doesn't have to have necessarily subject matter expertise in the area. And it shows that this can be done. So it's achievable. So as far as I'm concerned, Ben Carson is another one that ought to be looped into the DOGE effort, and they ought to be getting him to debrief them on a daily basis. This is how I did it, and this is the steps, and this is the crap they threw at me.
But he's a systems thinker who has moral principles, integrity, and he's got a brilliant mind. So when you're a systems thinker, you can be like a polymath, you can do different
Yeah,
things and
well put.
adapt quickly. So I think that's what we're going to need is folks like that's what the founding fathers were. They were systems thinkers, and they weren't their resumes and CVs didn't always match up what they ended up doing. But I really appreciate you coming on. I do want to just leave you with this thought as we wrap up, which is that I think the real value of this election so far, aside from whatever details of things he can accomplish or not, is the narrative win it gives for folks like us in the media and the culture war, and I mean the culture war in a different sense, not in the traditional sense of what people think it is, but really just having a cultural narrative Overton window or whatever shift towards these things that once the cat's out of the bag, you can't put back in. Like I don't know. We talked a little bit about it, but I've been doing the seed oil topic for years.
Yes.
Nobody was doing it on daily radio news like me, tying it to the
Good on
political
you.
culture. And now everybody's doing it. And I did that starting around 2018, 2017 on daily iHeartRadio FM AM. And it's now become, it's not just me, but all
Good
these
for
other
you.
great folks all pushing this thing together becomes this thing that's really big. You can't put that back in. You can't put that cat back in the bag. Once you understand when you start getting rid of seed oils and adapting to tallow and other things like that, and you see the health benefits, it's not like if Kennedy and those guys failed to deliver on the political promise that they're just going to forget and just, oh, let's just do seed oils now. I mean, these are poisons. And once you realize what they do to you and you remove them and you feel the benefit from them.
So I acknowledge, David, your leadership, and thank you for that. And I'm reminded of yet another meme that we put out in the funnies that shows Nancy Pelosi marching away with her cell phone and followed by her entourage. And the byline on the meme is sell seed oil.
Yeah, exactly. That's
Playing
a lot
off
of that
on.
going on. Yeah.
Playing off on Pelosi's stock insider trading. But good on you. And there's so much that can be done in the ag sector and the food sector.
Yeah.
And the powerful, powerful thing of Make America Healthy Again, the MAHA movement, is that it clearly cuts across genders,
Yeah.
it cuts across political categories.
Yeah.
It is something that younger cohorts are very enthusiastic about. In retrospect, you look at that and you go, well, why didn't the politicos figure this out like
Yeah.
cycles ago? Because this is powerful stuff. And I agree with you, it's not going to go away. And that underscores my comment earlier. Whatever goes down during Trump, and we're not going to find all of it particularly nice. Some things we're going to like, some things we're not going to like. And if we're going to be outside of government, then I think we have a obligation to continue to speak truth,
Right.
and to criticize and support, criticize and support where it's valid, and celebrate the wins. But the MAGA and MAHA movements have to transcend this administration. We have to make them sustainable. I'm reminded of Jenny Beth Martin, who you probably know, and her Tea Party Patriots group. Jenny Beth just works like a trooper, just works and works and works on election integrity and all kinds of things. But what happened to Tea Party patriots? You know, it's kind of just petered out. And that would be a shame if our momentum, which I argue shouldn't, it should transcend populism. If we're just a populist movement, then we ought to just pack it up, go home, celebrate the win, and let's all get drunk. But if this is something more, and people really believe that they want to make America great again, and they want to make America healthy again, and they want to transform agriculture and food, then let's put our shoulder to the wheel and continue to push hard.
Amen to that. I appreciate your time, sir. And it's always great having you on. Malone.news is the best place to find your news and blog. Anything else you'd like to leave us with?
Buy the damn book.
Yeah.
Cyborg.
I
I'm
would.
sorry to shill books, but I have to.
Yeah, very good. Have you looked
Yeah.
into Rene Girard's stuff? I want Have you looked into his stuff yet? I've talked about him before.
Remind me, Gerard.
Rene Girard was the Stanford professor, anthropologist, mimetic theory.
Yes. Yeah,
Peter Thiel
somewhat. I
was his
think we
famous
refer to
student.
some of that in the book. Yeah.
Okay.
But there's so many that have contributed to our understanding of modern information, media, censorship, propaganda, and these modern technologies that have become so powerful of psychological manipulation and really warfare, that's at the center of modern NATO policy. It's somebody asked me today, was talking about the book. They said, "Well, does this election make it obsolete?" I said, "Are you kidding? This tech is so powerful, they're not going to give it up. Not now. We're going to live with it the rest of our lives and beyond."
Well, very good. We got the war has only begun. It's only just getting started.
There we go, David. And you and I may end up looking a little bit like Ron Paul, but I'll take that. That following in his footsteps, I think, would be an honor for all of us.
Very good. Thanks for your time, Dr. Malone.
Thank you.